Okay, so what we'll do is we just try and urge people to mute themselves when they join the session so that it doesn't interrupt, you know, the flow of discussions. So as soon as you join the sessions, please, if you could mute yourself, that would be very, very useful. Thank you. Prof, you can start now, I think.
Yeah, let's make a start.
So, what do you want to do? Do you want to want me to go straight or?
Yes, please.
Do you want to say anything before people in terms of housekeeping?
Okay.
Yeah, and then Kenneth and I will make a few remarks, but Ade, you can go ahead now.
All right. Okay, welcome everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to you all, wherever you're joining us from. My name is Dr. Ade Oyedijo. I'm the founder and the director of the Society of Black Academics. It's a pleasure to have all of you guys here today. Join us for our second annual conference.
I don't know where she went after we landed.
The guys in the lobby, you may be able to.
I might be able to mute everyone, Ade, if I'll go through the list, okay?
Ade, you're muted.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, it's a big pleasure to have you guys join us here today for our second annual conference titled Impactful Research and Scholarship. So I wouldn't go too much into the details of what that means because that's why we've got our guest speakers here. Having said that, I would really just do some housekeeping or inform us of some housekeeping. Number one is that this platform is for us to learn from each other, to understand you know, how we can make progress as Black academics. And we're doing that because, I mean, statistics shows that we are not a lot of Black academics, especially at senior level. So it is not really a platform for us to moan or to complain about things, but actually to take one or two things away that would help us become better individuals. Housekeeping rules are that let's keep questions coming in the chat section. Please, let's mute ourselves as well when we are joining the sessions, and hopefully we'll have a good session. Today we have Professor Kenneth Ameshi, who will be giving an opening remark, and also we have Professor Ken Kamuche, who is the host from the University of Nottingham. Professor Ameshi, I'll pass it over to you. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Ade. Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon or evening, where you are. I know our friends in America are still asleep. So, it's my pleasure to welcome you all to this event. Last year, we hosted it at the University of Edinburgh. That was the 3rd and 4th of June, and we had very interesting sessions. And as Ade mentioned, nothing much has changed in between. So back then, it was less than 1% of Black academics in the UK that were professors. It's still the same now. I know some of my very good friends, for example, Judy Muturi has added to that number since the last time we met, so which is progress in itself. And I also know that there are others Dr. Ade normally updates from time to time. So that's a pleasure and something positive we need to celebrate. And as mentioned, the whole idea is not to complain. We know there are obstacles. If we dwell on the obstacles, we won't make any strategic headway. So I tend to see three P's as a way to go through this. One is to remain positive, irrespective of the challenges we encounter, even in the course of the discussion. And the other is also to be progressive. You know, let's recognize the challenges, but let's be creative and innovative about how we get through these obstacles. And the last P there is to be peaceful, be calm. Sometimes we are stereotyped to be aggressive, to be loud, and to be all sorts. But within that, we can still find peace. We can still air our views. in ways that will still reflect and the respect and values we hold there. So I'm encouraging us all to use today as a way to, as an opportunity to reflect on our academic careers and journeys in the UK in particular and further afield. And this is not just about young scholars, it's also about established scholars, what we can learn from each other. And that way we share our strengths and weaknesses in ways that would engender collective learning. So without saying much more than this, I will hand over to Ken Kamoche, who is our host and in a lovely Nottingham. I wish I were there in person. So you could host us at your beautiful Jubilee campus. Ken, over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ken. And a warm welcome to all of you, wherever you happen to be. My name is Professor Ken Kamoche, Professor of Human Resource Management and Organizational Studies at the University of Nottingham. And I lead a group called the Africa Research Group, which is hosting this event. The Africa Research Group, as some of you will know, because I recognize some of the names here and some of the faces, and warm welcome to you all. We are a community that believes in networking and working together. Sometimes putting in joint research applications, holding workshops, a biennial conference, which often result in books and journal special issues. And so I would urge you all to join, especially if you happen to be working within the business school community. So last year I was privileged to attend the first meeting and I offered to host this event because I think it's a really good space for us to get together and discuss these issues. But first I would like to express my gratitude to Dr. Ade Oyedijo and his team for putting together this event successfully. It's been a challenge, partly due to my absence. I'm on study leave this year, and I've been away in Kenya and Rwanda on occasion where I've had difficulties, but sometimes connecting. But we managed to overcome those communication and then connectivity issues, and here we are today. So it's looking great. And in fact, what I would like to do, it's a little thing that I do with my students when we have these, when we're going through these the blended learning. And I say to them, if you don't mind, could you put in the chat the name of the city or the town where you are logging in from? Because I give of where everyone is. I mean, Nottingham, as I mentioned, but you know, if you feel happy to let us know where you are, that will give us a sense of where everybody is. And hopefully that will make for some interesting observations. I'm only here in Nottingham. I wish I was in some exotic destination, and I'm sure that I will envy some of you, wherever you happen to be. So just moving on to today's event, I think it's a really significant event because there are issues that Black scholars face in the West, certainly, and also indeed in Asia. And I spent about 10 years working in Hong Kong, so I know there are some, you know, really specific issues that Black scholars face out there. And these issues are unique to us and our particular circumstances. Issues that actually begin right at the very start of our career as research students. Simply getting through the door in your first job, or your very name itself might work against you. Remember the joke that President Obama made about, you know, his funny sounding name. And there's a lot of seriousness about that. So let alone the subsequent concerns about, you know, things like unconscious bias at recruitment, grant applications, performance evaluations and promotions throughout your career, and it goes on. So these are important issues that impact your career progression as a Black scholar and have very significant implications for your very identity as an academic, how you're perceived by colleagues, university management, and ultimately how you craft your career and engage with questions about impact, credibility, your legacy, and so forth. As Kenneth mentioned, and I would like to acknowledge Kenneth for providing leadership to this community, we are unlikely to address all of these issues today to everyone's satisfaction, but we will have a go, we'll make a start, and guided by our very eminent scholars who have very kindly agreed to share their thoughts, reflections, and experiences with us. So I'm looking forward to a very exciting discussion, and I will now hand over to Dan, who will explain the order of play and introduce the speakers for the very first session. Over to you, Dan. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Ken Kamuche, for that fantastic speech, actually, as the host of our second annual conference. So we'll get straight into it due to time. Our first session, or our first track, tackles the issue of scholarship. So we ask the question, what exactly is impactful scholarship? And we're looking at this from a very critical perspective. In this session, we have our moderator to be Professor Kenneth Ameshi, who is a professor of sustainable finance and governance at the School of Transnational Governance, European University Institute in Italy. But for this particular track, we have two speakers, wonderful speakers. The first is Professor Gloria Hyemeng, who is the Executive Dean of School at Royal Holloway University, University of London. And also we have Dr. Doyin Atewo Logun, who is the Dean of the Rhodes Scholarship at the University of Oxford. After that, we then have, so please don't go away because we still have many interesting sessions. We have the next one, which is on the routes to impact. And we're asking, how does one go about developing routes to impact from a teaching and research angle? We have two fantastic speakers at that session. We have Joe O'Leary, who is the head of equality, diversity and inclusion at UK Research and Innovation, UKRI. And we also have Professor Emmanuel Ogbonna, who is the Professor of Management at Cardiff University. That session will be chaired by our host, Professor Ken Kamuche. After that, we have the third session, which is on the tools and techniques. At the end of the day, we need to understand what are the tools and techniques for impact and how can we, you know, make progress with that. And in that session, we have two speakers, Professor Funmi Olonishakin, who is the Vice President of Global Engagement and Professor of Security.
Sorry, Ade, you're mute.
I do apologize, everybody. I've been saying, I've actually gone through the program.
You've gone through it, Reverend, just in the last 20 seconds or so. So don't worry about it.
Okay. All right. So I'll go back to the third track, which we have on tools and techniques for impact. We have two speakers, Professor Funmi Olonishakin, who is the Vice President for Global Engagement, and she's also a professor of security, leadership, and development at King's College. But we also have in that session another speaker who is Professor Kemi Yekini, who's a professor of accounting at SOAS, University of London. That session will be moderated by Dr. Tiromani Nadan, who's a chair of anti-racism and learning technology special interest group at the Association for Learning Technologies in the UK. The final session would be on navigating pitfalls and challenges. We would get some practical examples, some call to actions, and also we would also learn about recruiting for senior positions in higher education. That session will be chaired by Dr. Gillian Stokes, who is an assistant professor at the Social Research Institute, UCL, University College London. And also we have with us for that session speakers such as Professor Robert Mokaya, who is the Pro Vice Chancellor for Global Engagement at the University of Nottingham, and also a professor of materials and chemistry. We also have Professor Emmanuel Adegbite, who is a professor of accounting and corporate governance, and also the head of accounting department at Nottingham University Business School. Lastly, for that session, we have Dr. Becca Francine, who is the co-chair of EDI, Equality, Diversity and Inclusion, at Peret Lava. Peret Lava is one of the largest recruiters for senior positions in higher education, and it's a pleasure to have Becca join us as one of our practitioner speakers. So that's the rundown of our session today. But I would pass it on back to Professor Ken Ameshi, who will share the first session on what exactly is impactful scholarship. Professor Ameshi, over to you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And also, good to see you, Doyin. It's been a long time now, right?
I know.
Professor Gloria Hyemeng. I hope I pronounced it well.
It's okay.
Do you pronounce it?
Hyemeng. The G Sorry? Is Ajiman.
Ajiman, okay, great. Okay, great. So I need to recognize that. Thank you all. Let's go straight into it. I think we, Ade, what time do we have? When do I stop?
Okay, so we're running just about 5 minutes behind schedule. We should stop 9:50 or so. But okay, you can run it to 9:55. Just
okay, great. That's fine. I think it's a good time for us to have a chat. So let's go straight into it. You know, we talk about impactful research as well as scholarship. And the UK has been talking about that now, and it's the main thing, isn't it, in a way? So the idea that we need to conduct impactful researches. But what is the link then between research and scholarship? Because there are two things there. So it can have an impactful research, but it can also be an impactful scholar. So if we are to make a distinction between the two, let me start with Doyin. What would come to mind? How would you made that distinction between research and scholarship?
Good morning, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be here, or good day, wherever it is you are. You know, this was an interesting, it's an interesting question, because I think for so many of us, we use those words interchangeably. So it was really thinking about the preparation for this conversation that it got me to actually ask the question, in my view, what is the difference? And in some ways, one of the ways, of course, they're very related. In some ways, research is what you do to answer questions that you don't know, like many of us know that. And scholarship is what you do to find out what other people have found out. So other people know, and you're kind of doing your own exploration of the body of work that's already in practice, that's already been that's already in knowledge, that's already available. But also, you know, another person can look at research as actually really quite precise in terms of, you know, kind of the methodologies, the publication, like those process. But scholarship is almost like the profession, is kind of broadly how you manage yourself in the academic context. So I think they're both quite related, but it's also interesting to think, okay, where does one stop and where does the other one begin? And I think for me, it's helpful to think about it using the first definition, i.e. the thing I do to contribute to knowledge is research, but the thing other people have done to contribute to knowledge and me and my exploration and engagement of that is scholarship. So that is my take. I would love to hear other people's.
Yeah. Very, very interesting. Yeah. Perspective. Let's go to Professor Ajimang. What do you think about the same question of scholarship and research?
Thank you. And can I say thank you to all of you for attending this session? Thank you to Fade for developing this wonderful network. It's nice to see so many Black academics from the world. That's really fantastic. I think I would start by saying that as academics, we are scholars. Okay, that's what we are. We are all scholars. We pursue intellectual activities. We love reading. We love studying. We love questioning. We love developing our thinking and our ideas. So we are all scholars. And then I think we all engage in scholarship, whether we distinguish between scholarship and research. We all engage in scholarship because we're scholars. There is often the distinction that Doyin mentioned about scholarship being keeping up to date. Scholarship being about maintenance of the intellectual structure of subjects and disciplines. Scholarship being ways and means of us improving our skills as academics. Scholarship in that respect is a bit like CPD, continuous professional development. But to the extent that we are all scholars, we live, breathe, intellectual, reading, studying, questioning, then perhaps scholarship is more broad than than perhaps the distinctions, the definition suggests. I mean, of course, research, again, Doyen mentioned, research is about exploring new frontiers of knowledge. And I like Doyen's suggestion that in research, we're looking at our own things, whereas in scholarship, perhaps we're thinking about what others have done. But research, I see it as more about exploring new frontiers of knowledge, creating and disseminating new ways of thinking. But I think the key point is that we are all scholars. We are all scholars. So whether we are engaged in scholarship in the minute way of defining it, or whether we're engaged in research, primarily we have intellectual curiosity, and that's why we are academics. There are grey areas, of course. There are grey areas. So let me test you. Suppose you spend time thinking in the bath. Is that scholarship or research? What about, suppose we attend conferences? We are at conferences, we're making presentations at the conference, or we are part of the audience in the conference. Are we acting as scholarship? Is that scholarship or research? As I'm sure we can all argue that thinking in the bath is scholarship and it's also research, because if you didn't do your thinking, how can you actually do your project?
Yeah. But if you keep it that way, then it becomes broad, then every person becomes a scholar, right? In that sense, so every person here, including any person who can think. But coming back, I think I like the point you're trying to make between research and scholarship. And you're saying, we are scholars. And I want to take that point, that identity of being a scholar, and reflect on it a bit. And I go back to Doyen here. What does it mean to be a scholar? Without putting you on the spot necessarily, that identity of a scholar, what does it look like? I think you want to unmute yourself, do you?
Apologies for that. So thank you. I think Professor Hajimang has, that idea of your professional identity, of your identity as a scholar. I think that is a very pertinent question, because when we think about identity, it helps us define the behaviors, the characteristics. It helps us understand the community that we belong to. And so if one of the takeaways from this conversation is together we provide a collective understanding for us of what critical scholarship and the value of critical scholarship, and therefore being a critical scholar, if we get to that point, I think we would have accomplished a lot. So when we think about some of the things that I've picked up in my career, there are many, and I'm sure we'll unpack this on this call. There is something that we've already talked about in terms of intellectual curiosity. And I was speaking to a PhD student yesterday around how you make your argument and how you have to almost separate yourself from your own position in order to be able to open yourself to other people's positions and to, critically, in some ways, like, understand and interrogate the data so that you understand an alternative perspective and an alternative argument to what you're saying. And I think sometimes when we think about intellectual curiosity, we can be, we can fall into a place where we're only thinking about data that supports, or perspectives that support, our natural approach of seeing things. And so for me, as we think through an idea of like scholarship and the identity of scholarship, or, scholar identity, it is also important to think, well, what are the ways in which people disagree with you, and how do you integrate that into your own thinking and enhance your own work in that way? So that is just one strand. There will be many other strands in terms of us thinking about our own identities and how comfortable we are with the idea of you know, upholding that scholar identity.
Mm. I think that's very interesting. And you also introduced something as more complex than I thought, which is about critical scholar. You mentioned something like that. And somebody has already picked that up in the chat and saying, what's the difference between scholar and a critical scholar? And I know in management scholarship, you know, there's the idea of critical management scholarship, which in itself has a baggage, not a baggage, but it has its own. And people, I mean, whether you're thinking about critical accounting, critical marketing or whatever, it has that sense of being iconoclastic in approach, you know, so you try to challenge the status quo, critique. And sometimes you critique without answers anyway, but you say, oh, that critique in itself is useful. It's also a contribution to knowledge. But here I'm also thinking whether we can also begin to say, well, research can be one of the attributes of a scholar, right? You know, in terms of going back to the qualities of that identity. So a scholar engages in research, but research does not exhaust the reality of scholarship. A scholar can also be a teacher, a disseminator of that knowledge. A scholar can be a consultant. I remember when I did my sabbatical at the National Pension Commission Nigeria, I described myself as a scholar in residence. I didn't call myself an academic, because being an academic in that setting, I thought people would think I'm too theoretical or ivory tower thinking kind of thing. But being a scholar in residence was acceptable in a way. There's kind of legitimacy question there, isn't it? You know, and I felt cool in that sense, although the acronym sounds also great, SIR, S-I-R, right? You know, I'm trying to play with So I think what I'm trying to say in essence is that the whole idea of scholarship can encompass other things we do as academics beyond research. I don't know whether that would be something many of us here will agree with. And if I move from there a bit then, and we are talking about impact here. So we have scholarship with impact, we have research with impact. So what would an impactful research look like? Let me go to Professor Ajiman here. What is an impactful research?
Okay. I was going to talk about impactful scholarship to try
okay,
to.
Okay, but you can start with impactful scholarship.
To create the space. I like the fact that you said scholars do not just have to be researchers, the scholars are also teachers. Okay, scholars are teachers. Scholars work in, they contribute to the development of disciplines. You know, disciplines, they're members of learned societies. They write for professional outlets. So if you're an impactful scholar, so if you're doing impactful scholarship, I think it will have an impact on education in terms of innovative teaching, writing case studies, production of textbooks, contributing to debates about the discipline, but it will also have an impact on the practice. Of course, I'm coming from an accounting background, so my examples are from accounting. Articles that are published in professional outlets like accountancy, for example, practice in the sense that the scholarship is helping the public understand accounting. And then if you do scholarship in accounting, the expectation, or in any other discipline, the expectation, of course, is that you be drawn upon as an expert. And these are ways of creating that impact. I mean, impact simply is, and I saw this from Mark Reed, Newcastle University. He said, the good that researchers can do in the world, that is what he defined as impact. And that's fantastic, because it gets us to move away from maybe just economic impact or just societal impact. It's broader. It's a good The reason why we're doing the research, we're doing the research because we want to have an impact on change. There's a quote, I like reading about Einstein, you know, and Einstein said something which is really very important, I think, in terms of us as scholars and as impactful scholars. He says, concern for man and his fate must always form the chief objective of all technological endeavors. In order that the creations of our mind shall be a blessing and not a curse to mankind. Never forget this in the midst of your diagrams and equations. So actually he's talking about impact, all the things that we're studying, all the endeavors, everything we're doing in our mind really is to have an impact on man and woman, of course, humankind. We need to make what we do in our heads provide a blessing for mankind and not a curse to mankind. I thought that was absolutely wonderful because it takes us out of just looking at what we're doing and thinking about what we're doing, to be thinking about why we're doing it and the sorts of change that we want to achieve. Because I think impact is about being able to demonstrate change. There must be some benefit to X, whoever X can be, some benefit to the environment, if we're looking at environmental accounting research, for example.
Okay, great. I mean, let's stay on with that notion of impact, whether you want to look at it from a scholarship perspective or research perspective. And some of us, I can speak to for myself here. Because, I mean, my first degree was in philosophy, and I came into management scholarship, right? And I see management scholars who want to be more philosophical than philosophy professors. And I also have a consulting background, and I like to see my research in use. You know, I like to engage with people. And it's at that point that I say, well, I mean, I need my ideas because I have an idea. My work currently or recently is from CSR to sustainable finance. And I like to take those ideas I have into practice and engage with practitioners and learn from them as well. Somebody on the chat said, well, do you need to be in academia to be a scholar? You can be a scholar wherever you want to be. It does not necessarily need to be in the academia. And I know Doyin also, you're passionate about practice and having come from psychology and management and gender issues. How do you see impact in terms of your own space?
Yeah, absolutely. It is central to the work I do. And I have a number of reflections and learnings from my own experience. So I started I qualified as a psychologist, as an organizational psychologist. And I started working as an organizational psychologist. And then the questions emerged from my mind about what I could do a PhD in. So that for me was very interesting. I didn't come from a position where I just thought, oh, I wanted to do a PhD. It was like, actually, there was an issue with regards to leadership and diversity that I was grappling with my clients that made me think I need to study this. And so I think it is very important, even for any of us who even have a little bit of, you know, depending on how much work experience you had before your PhD, to the degree that there is some alignment, don't forget that. Don't, you know, think that, well, you know what, actually now all of that work, I will let that go. All of that kind of practical application. And now I'm going to, you know, focus on the research. But I think we were also fortunate, Ken, I wonder if you feel the same, in that, you know, we were affiliated. So I did my PhD at Cranfield School of Management, which is where Ken and I first met. And Cranfield has a very, very strong reputation for translating research into practice. So there were already networks, there were other relationships, there were already reports, there were already centers that actually was easy for me as an early career researcher to insert myself into. And then there was the expectation. So when we had our our reviews, you know, so we would have quarter reviews or we would have yearly reviews in terms of the progress you are making. There was often a question around, well, what is the benefit? I love what Professor Ashermang said in terms of, you know, what is the difference or the positive difference you're making to the world? So we connected. There were many people who also had a consultancy background while also doing high quality, rigorous research. So we had to marry the two. And so again, if this is something that is of interest to you, if in your environment, in your immediate education, you know, academic context, you're not, you know, you're not finding people who are asking those sorts of questions, then that is possibly the opportunity to think through what are the networks, what are the communities, what other places can I be where there is a value of the academic rigor, but there's also almost people saying, okay, what does that mean in practice? Ultimately, I think it is, you know, just to go back to what Ken said at the start in terms of, you know, my heart has always been in how is this work that I'm doing going to make an impact? So, for example, I'm involved in a project with Women's Higher Education Network where I'm using my research on women's experiences in senior leadership positions, particularly from an intersectional perspective, to help contribute to increasing the number of Black women professors in the UK. So my research is actually used when I'm running leadership development programs in the workplace and in academia. And I use my insights or the questions that come from there to ask additional questions in research. It's an iterative process. But what it does, and I think I just want to maybe land two paradoxes or tensions that if this is a thing that we want to do, that we just need to bear in mind. So one is, depending on the research that you're doing, I mean, for me, I do research that, you know, I've just give you an example of Black women in academia. I am a Black woman, and a lot of the work I do is in academia. So I am reflected in my work. I am aligned with my work, but I'm also possibly pigeonholed and stereotyped, possibly. I don't necessarily think that happens too much because I do good quality research. But for some of us who might be researching ourselves, just going back to some of the introductory remarks about what it means to be, you know, a Black scholar doing good work, you might want to think about, you know, do I want to study Black people's experiences? You might already have made those decisions. Or actually, am I just looking at, you know, I don't know, water management? And, you know, what are the price? What does it mean? Do you want to bring yourself into it? Because all research is kind of racialized from one perspective, you know, there are power systems, there are structures that influence what is valuable and what is not valuable, regardless of what exactly you're studying. So I think there's a question for us. I am comfortable with saying, yes, I'm a Black woman. I'm looking at Black women's experiences and I look at them using high quality, you know, rigorous methods. So therefore, just because I'm a Black woman doesn't mean that what I hear is necessarily my own experience. So that's one thing that I would like us to just, you know, almost sit with. I have another just paradox tension. If you're thinking about spending a lot of time doing practice and consultancy, and I'm sure, Ken, you know, this resonates with you, which is it takes time. The time that you're doing going out into the field, the time that you're doing speaking to people at work, the time that you're doing developing frameworks for, you know, everyday people to make sense of, that's taking time away from you attending academic conferences. That's taking time away from you writing proposals for grants. That's taking time away from you, you know, trying another draft of the fourth, you know, of a four-star journal, et cetera, et cetera. And so those are, you know, almost like decision points that we have to come to terms with if we want to do impact, a degree of a type of impactful work out in, you know, out in the field that in some ways in some ways clashes with the purest work within academia.
Okay, very, very fair points there. And I like the point you made about the racialization of knowledge production. And it's something we need to take seriously, and not from any negative sense. I remember trying to, because one of my cases was used for impact, was submitted as a kind of impact from Edinburgh. And my work more on African capitalism as well, was there was kind of a pushback even when we wanted to publish that work on African capitalism, because the question is, you know, what is this capitalism and Africa about it? As if Africa had no voice in the global production of knowledge. And we managed to convince Cambridge University Press, and it was this kind of a strategic move. And once Cambridge University Press published our work, then others started seeing it as something credible to talk about, right? So again, it's understanding the politics of it and taking advantage of it. And the other point also you made, you know, which we need to take into consideration, is that some of these things, they don't come without some doubt. Say, for example, if you want to present your case study, you might be asked some silly questions. I remember saying, oh, my work contributed to the Central Bank of Nigeria doing X and Y. I don't think they believed me, right? At some point, I have to go, you know, they ask a very mundane question, get letters, get, I mean, it was like, if my colleagues produced 3 letters, I was asked to produce 10 to support an argument I've made. Initially, I was frustrated about it, but I took it in good faith. I said, well, I need to get to the bottom of it. You know, that idea of being patient as well, not only in the publication, but also in the demonstration of evidence. But let me go to Professor Ajiman here, because he talked about impact from the perspective of doing good. And I think there is a comment on the chat and say, well, impact can also be negative. So we do research, for example. Now, if I research on how to kill people through drones in a quicker way, for example, that could be an impactful research in itself. Or if I'm able to find something on how to commit genocide, right? It's an impactful research. But is it good research in that sense? And even the idea of good can also be socially constructed. The idea of good can be temporary in the sense that a particular time, a particular age may see something as good, and a few years down the line, that same goodness becomes something else. So how do we try to make that decision and to remain useful? So there is an impactful research, there's also useful research in that sense. I don't know if you want to, if you agree with that kind of distinction. And what would be your thoughts on that?
I think, yes, some impactful research will lead to negative consequences. The issue about impact is being able to achieve change and demonstrate change in some way. Okay, knowledge is not stagnant. Knowledge is about the march of time. It's constantly changing. And therefore, any bits that you add to the knowledge can only develop humankind's knowledge further. I mean, I was touched by something Doyin said. Doyin said she started in industry. She started in industry as an occupational psychologist, and that's how she got into research. I started in accounting, and that's why I ended up in critical accounting, because I was working in those days, it was Coopers and Lybrand or PricewaterhouseCoopers. And the amount of time we spent doing, and nowadays I understand it, but those days it seemed to be really mundane, boring stuff. So I started questioning the whole of accounting. Of what use is this? That we should spend our time ticking, checking. What is the role of accounting? You know, and that's what took me into, if you like, more critical accounting, assessing what's the possibilities of accounting. To give you an example, and it's again, it touches on your point, Ken, about your work being questioned all the time. I started looking at accounting and immigration, accounting and migration. And the accounting academy was saying, there's no accounting in this. There's no accounting in this. Why would anybody be interested in doing this? But actually, if you take a critical perspective and you think about what the immigration policies are trying to do, there is a lot of accounting technologies being employed. There's a lot of accounting technologies being employed. And the fact that we're critical means that we're looking at alternative ways of looking at things. And then these alternative ways of looking at things will contribute towards knowledge, will contribute towards practice. It moves you away from looking at it from just one perspective to look at things that are hidden. And I think that's something that as scholars, as academics, we do very well, because who else in their profession has the time to think about different ways of doing things? And I think even though impact agenda is forcing us to look at positive as well as negative change to see how things are, I think even the act of gaining knowledge from different perspectives is also impactful. It's also impactful. I mean, we have, there's a group of us, we have a special edition that we're looking at, and I encourage you to contribute your papers, accounting and race. You know, we are trying to unearth how race has and is impacted by accounting, and how accounting impacts race, if any, from a historical perspective, from a multidisciplinary perspective, from whatever perspective you want to look at it at. And so we are pushing the boundaries in that respect. Now, I'm not sure that work will lead to change. I'm hopeful it will lead to change to the extent that it gets people to think differently about race and the contribution race, the positive contributions race can achieve. Sorry, go ahead.
No, continue, wrap up, then I can.
No, that's, go ahead. So what I'm saying is that when we think about impact, we tend to think about economic, commercial impact, maybe environmental benefits, but actually, there's also impact in terms of raising awareness, creating knowledge, public contributing towards public debate, okay? And all that is impactful research, and demonstrating it for ref becomes difficult.
Yeah.
And yet it is important. If anything, it's the most important thing.
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, just coming to the end of our session there, for those joining us, we've been talking about impactful research and scholarship. And I have the pleasure of talking to Professor Ajiman, or Gloria Ajiman, and Dr. Doyin Atewologun. Both are experienced academics reflecting on their different track records in the space. But I think what is coming true, I mean, I probably caused it because the kind of questions I asked were leading in a way, which in a way ended up problematizing or characterizing impactful scholarship or research as a heroic act, right? You know, a heroic act in the sense that as individuals, you know, we do these things ourselves. But I think that's a false narrative in the sense that impact is something we do collectively. Impact is also something that we need other people's support to do. I talked about my case at the University of Edinburgh, but I also had a fantastic colleague who helped me, and he's a white guy, right? And he helped me understand the system, he helped calm nerves, and you know, so he was kind of a useful ally in that sense. So there is also that tendency when we feel that we are always suspected, in quote, to demonstrate or prove that we can do certain things. But if you find those allies in the system, they can also help us, irrespective of where they come from. So I think the point I'm trying to make there, reemphasize, is that when we think about impact, let's not just see it as something we do alone, but something we do with others. And the same also as entrepreneurs. You know, entrepreneurs come along as kind of heroic figures, but entrepreneurs don't do everything alone. They still need others to help them actualize their vision. So if we begin to see our impact, I mean, whether through scholarship or research, from that collective mindset, it can also help shape things. So I know I have like 3 minutes to go a day. So let me leave Doyin and Gloria now to just kind of your parting words, maybe in a minute each before and then wrap up. So I'll go back to you, Doyin.
Thank you. It is so interesting what you said, because I wrote down, we haven't mentioned collaboration. So I wanted to leave our participants with three thoughts. Collaborate, collaborate, collaborate. It's a way to learn, it's a way to contribute, it's a way to be supported. It's a way to collectively make an impact, exactly like Ken has just said. The second thing, which is a little linked to that, is to look for feedback. Get feedback from different types of people. Feedback on your draft publications, of course. Feedback on your grant applications, of course. Feedback even on your promotion, you know, your draft promotion applications. Every time anybody else sees what you have written, they can give you their own perspective on how to make it better. And the last thing, I know we haven't, this is not really about promotion per se, but ultimately, in order, when we think about impact, we want career success. One of the work that I'm doing with Black women who want to be professors, I am surprised that so many of them don't know the answer to the question, what is the promotion process in your institution? If you look at that and you read it, and I know the issue of impact and scholarship is much broader. This is now somewhat utilitarian. But if we're going to kind of push ourselves forward, understand the rules of the game in the institution that you find yourself, and continue to get feedback and collaborate. Thank you so much for this opportunity and this invitation. I will pass now to Professor Ajimang.
And you continue to support us, and they will be on your back from time to time. Okay. Professor Ajimang, please.
So thank you, Doyin. And I agree with everything you've said, the collaboration, knowing the promotion criteria, etc. I mean, one thing I want to add is people need to research with interest. Find what interests you and let that drive your passion. And let that drive your research, because I think you have more successes if you research with interest. Look for the problems that engage you, because those problems would encourage you also to look for solutions. And I think that's the starting point of impact. If you're interested in, one of the things I research in is water management, urban water management. Because I go back to Ghana and I see people still after 50 years carrying water on their heads. So that's, I feel very passionate that this should not be happening. So I do a lot of research in water and urban water management. And because I'm interested in that, because I'm prepared to sacrifice all the time I have in that research, eventually, the impact will happen, if not for anything at all, for the noise you make through your research. So I think it's important to research with interest and research with passion, and that comes out through your performance. And then, of course, comes the promotion. It's another battle for us all to fight for, but it will come. So thank you again. Thank you to SBA for inviting me to this session. I've really enjoyed it. I'm going to stay for the rest. Morning.
Yes, I encourage others to stay as well. And it's has been a fantastic conversation, and time flies. But just quickly to answer your question, somebody put on the chat about my take on Afrocapitalism and how I was able to convince the Cambridge University Press. It's always good to know that track record matters, right? So when I went to Cambridge University Press, it wasn't just the Afrocapitalism. They also looked at what I've done before. And also the people, other colleagues working with me on the project. We had very good academics from all over. We had about 8 universities. Yeah, again, going back to the point I was making that you don't work alone. It's about collaboration, as Doyin mentioned, and it showed the breadth of our expertise. And people came from very good universities, very good research background, and based on our track record, in a way, they were able then to give us a chance. So it was kind of, well, let's see if whether this will work or not. But at the end, we produced fantastic, I would say, fantastic book chapters that eventually came together neatly. As you would know, when you're given a book project, it can either succeed or fail. So it was through the book publication process and gathering the books chapters together that we were able to convince them that we had something meaningful to offer. So they gave us a chance, we proved ourselves, and today African capitalism is where it is. And just again to say, after the Cambridge University Press one, we got a call from Routledge, and then we have another book with Routledge, and Oxford University Press has approached us, but we haven't had time to do that. So if you think you can push that, there is a space for you there to go to Oxford University Press and do a book on African capitalism. Permit me to stop there and hand over back to Ade to continue. And I will be here and come back towards the end again. Thank you very much, Ade. And thank you, Doyin and Gloria.
Thank you very much, Professor. Thank you, Professor Gloria. Thank you, Dr. Doyin as well. Fantastic insights shared. But before we go, I would like us to take a question, and Professor Ameshi, you could take this or any of our speakers, which is there any specific skills to acquire to have an impactful research or scholarship? Thanks. I think that's an important question, especially for maybe early career researchers or PhD students that want to, you know, start thinking about impactful research and scholarship from now. Thank you.
Okay, let me see if I can summarize what Professor Ajiman and Dr. Tewologun have said in a nutshell. One of the key things to do is to start with a real-life problem. Right? If you start with a real-life problem, then it helps you. So Professor Ajiman had issues with accounting. You know, he wanted to understand, change accounting, because kind of practical thing. Doyin talked about psychology and Black women and their problems and their issues. If you start with problems, it's easier than to walk back and say, you know, what sort of questions can help me address these challenges? And once you do that, then you're able to do that. But the other issue, people tend to start with theory, although it's also been said there's nothing as practical as a good theory. So, but that quote works when you start with real-life problems. Otherwise, you end up creating imaginaries in the head, and they will need time to translate into practice as well. So I would say start with real-life and then walk back into the academia, and then that's how you can make quick impact. Just in the interest of time, so there you can manage the rest of your day and be impactful as well. So.
Yes, thank you very much. I think that's a very important response, a very good response to that. There is also another question that has been flagged. I'm really sorry. I've got to take these questions because it's a way for us to interact with our participants. It is saying that, is it possible to go beyond our experiences and identities and still conduct impactful research? So how can we navigate the challenges that could emerge from conducting research that are beyond our comfort zones, experiences, and identities? Please, anybody from our speakers or Professor Ameshi could pick that as well. Thank you. And that will be our last question.
Okay, yeah, let's have Professor Ajiman answer that.
I think networking is very important. That comes back to the collaboration points that we have mentioned. We all have can join teams and contribute, what skills we have towards teams. And also most problems, wicked problems, are interdisciplinary problems. So we need to be able to move away from just our comfort area of accounting or psychology to reach out to the engineers, the marketing people, the scientists, etc. Especially if also we're looking for funding, because that's something we didn't mention. Impactful research also requires significant amount of funding. So I think working in teams is absolutely crucial. And then teams where we have a variety of skills, but that because one person is not going to be able to find a solution to a big problem, that invariably impactful research is addressing.
Fantastic. Thank you very much for your response, Professor Ajiman. Actually, our next session doesn't start till 10:20. So we're supposed to start our break.
Maybe before you go on break, now just to add, because that person asked a question about identity, comfort zone, and so on and so forth.
Yes.
And I've just put something in the chat there, right? If you want to do that, be strategic, right? You don't want to be in perpetual discomfort. I wouldn't encourage it. It's not good for academia, right? You need to do something you enjoy. If you want to step out of your comfort zone, be strategic, do it, let it be a short-term thing, and you do it in such a way that it eventually becomes your comfort zone. If you remain in perpetual discomfort, you will not enjoy the academia. There's no point trying to be unhappy throughout, you know. So trying, you know, what are you proving? Who do you want to convince? You know? So it's all about yourself as well. And it's your identity, it's your career, and you manage it as you wish. When I came, my research is on CSI in Africa. And I do it on purpose because I want my research to contribute to what is happening in Africa. It doesn't mean I can't do research in the UK, but it's also from a pragmatic reason. When I came into the UK, getting access into these companies was a challenge. I'm currently in Italy on a leave of absence from the University of Edinburgh, and I'm facing the same challenge, even the challenge of language. How do I get into Italian companies? So if I want to say I want to go into my area of discomfort, first I have to go and learn Italian, right? And how much discomfort do I want to cause myself? Then learn Italian, not learning the street language Italian. I have to learn sophisticated Italian to speak to managers, right? And then I get into, but do I have the network? Even if I have the language, do I have the network that will take me into the kind of research I want to do? So as much as I want to do those things, I also need to be realistic and pragmatic. So there is that balancing act there. At the end of the day, impactful scholars are also great publishers. So what sort of data do you have access to that can help you publish? If you're publishing, whether it's on Nigeria or Kenya or Cameroon, as long as you're publishing, that work counts in the academia. Then if you have this find for yourself, the idea of being a global scholar, okay, so I want my work to be used anywhere in the world. It's a different challenge. And there's nothing wrong. We can also position ourselves as global scholars. Michael Porter is a global scholar. Why can't we have a Black professor, a Black academic that can also be an equivalent of Michael Porter, and his works can be cited anywhere in the world? Wole Soyinka, for example, from Nigeria, is a global scholar. Chinua Achebe is a global scholar. Chimamanda Adichie is a global scholar in that sense, because their works are used all over the world. So, again, I think the point I'm trying to make is be strategic. Let it not be something you dabble into because you want to prove anything to anyone, but look at it from the point of how can I convert this opportunity to something that will help me in my career ultimately. And I said, as long as you remain comfortable, your comfort matters to help you produce good scholarship. A bit of discomfort can also help, but don't stay in that discomfort longer than necessary.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you very much, Professor Ameshi, for that wonderful response. We also have a question here, which is about how important, I guess that part is important, Gillian, how important is transdisciplinary / cross-disciplinary collaboration these days? And I think that comes off what Professor Ajiman was saying about, you know, even being in accounting and collaborating with people in engineering, etc. So maybe you could touch on that a little bit more, Professor Gloria. Thank you.
It's really about how to get funding. Often in order to get funding, they're looking for a team. They're looking for a team addressing a problem. The problem is not going to be in one discipline area. Okay, and that's why collaboration, interdisciplinary collaboration is important these days. Of course, you can, if you're in accounting, you can get funding from the accounting professional bodies. You know, but colleagues of mine working on, for example, environmental sustainability issues, invariably have had to work with geographers, people in, and other people in science as well. It's a case of the wicked problems require several disciplines to be engaged in. And I mean, in our field, social science fields, there isn't that significant. If you were looking for huge amounts of funding, the 1 million, the 2 million, it tends to follow the sciences. And that's why working with across disciplines such as science is often beneficial. I mean, if you will get the odd 20K, 40K, 50K, et cetera, from professional bodies, et cetera. But if you really want to make an impact, you have to do a big project with a strong team. Invariably, it has to be an interdisciplinary team.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Professor Gloria, for that. I think that question or that particular point would actually continue in our session, in our next session, which would be on routes to impact. So how does one go about developing it from a research and teaching angle? And in that session, which would start at 10:20, we would have Professor Emmanuel Ogbonna from Cardiff University, and also Joe O'Leary, who is the head of Equality, Diversity and Inclusion at the UKRI. So UKRI is a UK research and innovation, and that's a funding body for scholars in the UK. So we'll probably be posing some of those questions to Joe as well. But I think we are almost out of time. Sorry, if you could please mute yourself, whoever that is. Thank you. So I think that brings us to the end of our first session. We've got so many points that we've taken away, starting with the real life problem, networking and collaboration, being very strategic, of course. Do something you enjoy, be in your comfort zone. Of course, good scholars are great publishers as well. So if you want to be impactful, you have to be able to disseminate your work as well, because that's one way to show impact. And of course, positioning as a global scholar beyond your context or your perspective, your area, is very important as well. Thank you very much to Professor Kenneth Ameshi for moderating this session. Thank you to Professor Gloria Agimang and Dr. Doyin Atewologu for being fantastic speakers for this session. We will take a 10-minute break now, and we will then come back at 10:20 to continue for our next track, which will be moderated by Professor Ken Kamuche. But in the meantime,
10:20, right? Oh, sorry, 10:20.
Sorry, 10:20, yes. 10:20. So we've got a break from 10:10 to 10:20. But in the meantime, before you go for the break, just to mention to you guys that we will encourage you to hashtag, post comments, tips or quotes, whatever you've picked up from our sessions. Post them on Twitter, on Instagram, on LinkedIn, as that you know promotes our event. And the hashtag is SBA. Conf. So second SBA conference, if you could post that, that would be very useful. Thank you, everybody. And Professor Ameshi, you wanted to say something, please, over to you.
No, not really. I was just kind of emphasizing on the time. So exactly.
Okay. All right. So we'll be back at 10:20. Thank you very much, everybody. And please don't go away. You can just leave your computers, get some water, tea, coffee, whatever makes you relaxed for the next 10 minutes or so, and we'll be back very soon. Thank you.
Holy, What if we leave it at that? Nothing to say, and everything gets in the way. Seems you cannot be replaced, and if you want to stay, oh, in this world, it's just us. And all is not the same as it was in this world. It's just us. And all is not the same as it was. As it was. As it was. And all is not the same as it was. Harry, you're no good at all. Why have you said anything? What kind of pills do you want? Ring in the bell. Nobody's coming to help. Your definitely is what we say. Just wants to know that you have. In this world, it's just us. And all it's not the same as it was. And it's worth, it's just us. And all it's not the same as it was, as it was, as it was. And all it's not the same.
I'm gonna hit by speed in the head. I don't think I'm talking about the way that you work.
Okay, Professor Ken Kamuche, are you there? Hello, Joe. Morning. I think you're on mute, Joe.
Hello. Yeah, I was trying to unmute and my mouse wouldn't work. Ian, it's really nice to join you. Thank you for the invitation.
You're welcome. Thank you very much for agreeing to be here. I know you're a very busy person.
You're very welcome.
Thank you very much. Okay, so we'll just start the next session now. I'm just going to wait for our moderator to join us before we start. And then I would just confirm our second guest speaker, Professor Obunna. Just bear with us, please. Thank you.
Yeah, hello, Ade. I'm on. I'm ready now, whenever you are.
Okay. Yes, Prof, just bear with me a second. Let me just try to get Professor Obunna as well. Thank you.
Hi.
Oh, fantastic. Hello, Prof. Emmanuel.
Hi, can you see me?
Yes, we can.
I think somehow my name is disappeared on the screen, so I'll have to try and work it as we go along.
No. We can see you.
We can see you.
Okay.
Okay, good morning. Okay, Professor Kamuche, over to you now.
Okay, and we have both speakers.
Yes, we have Professor Emmanuel Obunna and Joe O'Larry from UK.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much, Ade. And a warm welcome to everyone for turning up for this second session. And a warm welcome to you, Emmanuel Obunna and Joe O'Larry. It's a pleasure to have you in this session. I believe we've got, 40 minutes a day, 20 minutes for each of the speakers. What I'm going to do is kind of mix it up a little bit, and I'll give each of our speakers their 20 minutes of fame, and I'll engage with them and also invite some participation from the audience. But without further ado, I would like to just welcome our first panelist, Joe O'Leary, and ask you, Joe, to if you could just give yourself a quick give us a quick introduction about yourself and the work that you do or the UKRI does, just for starters, if that's okay.
How about you, Joe? Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation to join you. It's a real pleasure to be with you all today. I know that you had invited UKRI's CEO, Ottoline Leiser, to join you. Ottoline is actually busy today at an event on the UKRI strategy, but it's a real pleasure for me to be able to join you. I'm the head of the Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Strategy team at UKRI. And my history, how I came to be in this role, I did a degree and a postdoc. I then moved into research facilitation, and then I joined BBSLC, one of the research councils that makes up UK Research and Innovation, back in 2008. And for a long time, I worked on the delivery of funding and peer review. So I have a real background in funding policy and practice. I then spent a little bit of time working in UKRI on preparations for the UK's exit from the European Union. And then I joined the Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Strategy team in 2020.
Would you like me
to continue talking about the work of UKRI now, or do you want to do introductions first?
If you give us just a quick summary of what they do, so just to give us some background, please.
Sure. So UK Research and Innovation is it's a relatively new body. It was formed in 2018, and it brings together the seven research councils, Innovate UK, and a new organisation that was formed in 2018 called Research England. Our mission and vision is to support research and innovation across the UK. We fund research in universities, in independent research organisations. We fund innovation in those organisations. And through Innovate UK, we work with businesses to fund people working as innovators. We fund studentships, and of course through our grant funding we support the wider research and innovation community and all of the people that make that up. So whether that's people who are working as librarians or archivists or technicians, and that's our mission, is really around creating a thriving and inclusive research and innovation system for the benefit and impact of the UK and supporting the UK's growth as a leading science nation.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Joe. What I'll do now is, before I move to Professor Obona, I'm just going to ask a few questions of you. And I would just like to pick up on one of those points that you mentioned about inclusion. Because as you know, there have been concerns about the exclusionary policies where Black people find themselves facing challenges in securing funding, where sometimes they feel that they're not dealing with a level playing field. Perhaps they encounter significant obstacles, and their background sometimes have been said to play a role in this. And I just wondered whether what you can share with us regarding the perceptions of UKRI with regard to this question or this problem, and whether you're aware of any particular challenges in addition to those that I've mentioned that will ultimately impact on Black scholars having access to funding, certainly in the UK.
Sure. This is a real area of focus for UKRI. How do we create inclusive environments where everyone can flourish, where ideas can thrive? This is a really important foundational piece of our work. There are no silver bullets to improving diversity and inclusion. And I think we can often get trapped into thinking about problems and barriers and think about things from a deficit model, which can be really quite damaging. Now, that's not to discount experiences and situations and barriers as structural. There are systemic issues within the whole of the research and innovation system. So one of the pieces of work that we are interested in, and we've been starting to pilot this, is how can we reimagine what the research and innovation system could look like. So, and really thinking about behaviors and opportunities, how do we bring joy back into research and innovation? How do we create those environments where everyone feels welcome? So this is not just about increasing the numbers of people. So we talk about widening the door to let more people in. Maybe that's part of what we can do, but actually, do you want to be in that room? What does it feel like to be a researcher? What does it feel like to work in research and innovation? How do we start to change the culture around research and innovation? And so some of the work that we're doing, as I said, is about exploring different ways to imagine research and innovation. If we started again, what would that look like? How do we encourage behaviours and support and reward and recognise behaviours and actions that increase inclusion? We're also testing and rolling out a number of different initiatives. So we have rolled out the resume for researchers and innovators. So this is a narrative form CV, which enables people to describe their contributions in different ways. And that's a really important part of recognizing and valuing the many different contributions that people make and not getting trapped into cycles of metrics and measures that don't recognize as much wider contributions that people make. We've also been doing some piloting of anonymized peer review. I think we're probably at too early a stage to really know whether that's impactful. But these are different measures that we're looking at and different piloting that we're doing to really try and unpick what's happening and really understand what difference we can make and how we can use the levers that UKRI has to improve inclusion and improve diversity and representation.
Okay, thank you very much. That's very useful to know, especially when you mentioned things like in narrative CVs, because I think one of the challenges that Black scholars certainly face in putting in applications is that, as I mentioned in my opening remarks earlier on, your very name might actually work against you. And the idea that some of the subjects or areas in which we are working in may not necessarily appeal to reviewers. And perhaps having anonymized applications would be one way. And I just wondered, you touched on some of that. I wondered whether there has been any research by the UKRI to find out the extent to which this is actually a problem, to find out whether, to try and pick up on some of those specific challenges and the extent to which Black scholars or scholars of color are facing in terms of feeling that they are excluded, a research that perhaps might help us to improve our own ability to present ourselves in the best possible light.
Sure. So our data do show that there is underrepresentation of Black researchers, and that's true for UKRI. And I think one of the things that we have done is publish our data in disaggregated form so that we can really see what this means for people of different ethnicities and what our systems and processes show. So that's one thing that we're doing. That doesn't solve the problem, but it helps us to see where there may be issues. In terms of the anonymized assessment, I don't think we have enough information yet to know whether that's impactful or not. And I think that's an area where we can continue to explore. Other funders have done some testing of anonymized peer review or lottery funding. So there is lots of experimentation across the whole of the research and innovation system about different measures that organizations can take. One of the councils that makes up UKRI, the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council, did quite a large survey last year of people within the research and innovation system to really understand barriers for Black researchers and researchers and people of colour within the research system. We haven't published that report yet, but that's one way of really starting to understand those barriers. And then we have recently published our draft Equality, Diversity and Inclusion Strategy. And that strategy provides a framework for action plans that we are developing as an organization now. And those action plans will respond to this, to the engagement that we have with our stakeholders, to the insight that we're gaining through these surveying methods from our data. And that will help us to identify the actions we can take and then move forward in testing those interventions and importantly, evaluating those interventions and really understanding what works in terms of improving inclusion and diversity and representation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. In terms of working with various stakeholders, say universities and the various funding bodies, how much cooperation are you seeing? Are you seeing a real appetite to address these issues and provide solutions?
Appetite from across the research and innovation system?
Yes, and in particular from universities. I mean, I know that obviously with things like, you know, the REF, the Research Excellence Framework, and so forth, it's been a huge push for scholars, for researchers to engage in research and secure funding. But as to, you know, how much support Black scholars are actually receiving from universities. How prepared are universities to work with bodies such as yourselves to find solutions to these problems? How much of that are you finding, please?
So I think there's a huge appetite for change across the research and innovation system, and many universities have really invested in change in programs and positions to improve research culture within their own institutions. Now, I can't speak for how those programs are conducted within universities because those organizations manage those programs themselves. But I think we see real appetite, we see real engagement. We saw a really good response to our consultation on our equality, diversity and inclusion draft strategy. And part of that consultation, we asked questions about where do you as people working within the research and innovation system and organizations and partners see the opportunity to work together and with us to improve diversity and inclusion. And we're analyzing the output of those the consultation at the moment. But there's real appetite. And I think this is really important. We have systemic and structural problems, and so it's really important that we work together as a whole sector to address those issues, create the opportunities, and use the different mechanisms and levers that we have together to make sustainable change.
Mm-hmm. From where you sit, what do you think Black academics can or should do to be better positioned for success while putting in grant applications? Some practical information.
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I caught at the very end of the last session where one of the speakers was talking about, talking about finding joy in your research and also really being committed to your ideas and doing the research that you want to do. So I think those are really important things. In speaking kind of from my previous experience, where I spent a long time working with peer review panels and working with applicants for funding, I think that's really critical. What's the research that you want to do? How do you describe that research in a way that's exciting and innovative? How do you collect your preliminary data? How do you show those data, if that's appropriate, to tell the story? I think there are opportunities that perhaps aren't always taken up, and this goes across the board. So if there is a funding opportunity announced, there's often a webinar that sits alongside that to explain those opportunities. So really encourage people to attend those webinars, to sign up, to ask questions. There are many people in UKRI who support the delivery of our funding processes. If you're uncertain, ask a question. We're here to help. We're not a faceless organisation. We want to support researchers. And also, where you can, make the contacts within your own institution. So I know from my past experience of grant writing that it was really important for me to make contact and have good relationships with the research managers in my institution, because they were the people who could really help me in doing bringing my grant application together. And then I think there's also another really important point about learning from other people, learning from people who've been successful, and also perhaps learning from people who haven't been successful. What didn't go well? Why were they not successful? What would they have done differently? I mean, what did they do differently when they won the grant the next time around? And I think these things will help all of us as we submit our grant applications. So those would be my main messages.
Yeah, thank you very much. That's very helpful, not just for those of us who are within the UK, but also across the board, because researchers seeking funding in whatever jurisdiction they happen to be in will face similar challenges, and there will be those opportunities. And I like the idea of working with research managers within the universities, whatever resources are available there, as well as learning from others. So thank you very much, Joe. Don't go away. I'll come back to you later on. But I would now like to welcome Professor Ogbonna. I would just like to ask you, Professor Ogbonna, to quickly introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about some of the work that you do, please.
Okay, thanks very much for having me today. My name is Emmanuel Ogbonna, and I teach and research aspects of organizational theory and management. Lately, I have been working in the area of race relations. My PhD wasn't in that area, though. I kind of stumbled into the area just 2 years after my PhD. In a way, it's quite apt. The story is quite apt because of what we are talking about today, which is impact. It was 2 years into my academic career in the early 90s, and a phone call came to the business school where I work. It was from the Department of Employment, and they were looking for somebody to evaluate the old Training and Enterprise Council. They wanted to know why, in their view, Black and minority ethnic people were not as successful as their white counterparts from the tech. And I volunteered to do this work. And I did it with a colleague of mine then. We were both early career researchers, Mike Noon. Mike Noon is dean at Queen Mary now. And we both did that work. And it was very, very successful. And from that, we went on to do other things. And then I realized that a lot of the assumptions people made about race were incorrect. And I wanted to do something about that area. And I began to research race. So race equality has become an area where I have found quite a lot of satisfaction, not just in academic terms, but in terms of the impact of my work.
Thank you very much for that introduction. I have to say that one of your better known papers on call centers some years ago, I think with, I'm sure who it was, is a paper that I often use for teaching. So that's had an impact on my thinking as well. So anyway, thank you so much for joining us on this occasion. And I would just like to ask you a couple of questions, actually. One question I have in mind is, universities are starting to talk very much about impact. I mean, we see these changes in the themes in research, you know, whether it's about targeting, top quality journals over a number of years, and then the thinking seems to have changed a little bit towards, say, securing research funding, and then it's about collaboration and networking, and the big thing today is impact. Now, some are saying this is just a buzzword. Clearly, there is a significant amount of work going on in unpacking the idea of impact. And some universities are actually going down the route where they're saying we have a practitioner route to impact. And I just wonder, how can academics engage with such a route to impact? You know, in what ways can impact as a notion, as a theme in research, actually guide research in that sense?
Okay. So, yeah, you are right. Universities are being questioned by the stakeholders that make it possible for us to exist. You know, they are asking, of what use are universities really? Is it just to fund a group of academics to stay in their ivory towers and think of new and new theories. And society somehow has decided that that's no longer important to them, although I think it is a mistake to assume that. I think when you think about it, this is probably one of the few countries, maybe there are many, but in this particular country, the term theory is seen as a negative thing. And if you try to unpack that, you know, theory is actually not negative. If you were in a place like, for instance, in France, you know, theory will be seen as something desirable, like something positive. And what I always say to my students, especially my MBA students, is that there is no practice without theory. What is practice today was once theory that people have kind of tried to practicalize. But somehow we are trying to make the distinction in this country between the two. And my view is that we shouldn't, and that, you know, impact in that sense, it's something that I have always considered important in the work that I do. But in terms of your question, it is, I think, very important for us in universities to engage with both routes to impact, the practitioner route and the academic route. There are some people that are better at engaging in the practitioner route. There are some skills that we need to develop to be able to engage in the practitioner route. You know, often the practitioner route requires insight, you know, a level of insight into how organizations and sectors and the public sector in particular works that university academics don't always have. And it makes a lot of sense, I find, to try and link up with people in industry. Now, one of the things that I have found in the work I've done, especially in the last 2 years with government, is the number of people in government that are crying out to work with academics and don't know how to start. And I think trying to link those two would be a good way to have, you know, that balance that I think you need in academic life these days. But I do agree that more and more society is asking us to establish our relevance beyond publishing in top research journals.
Thank you very much for that response, which leads me to the next point, which is about the balance between impact and, if you like, practice on the one hand, and what some people might call blue skies research, which is really very much about, you know, the pursuit of knowledge for knowledge's sake, creativity. And I just wonder whether, in your opinion, do you think that this push towards impact and demonstrating relevance in some way challenges this idea of, you know, blue skies research, which is really very fundamental to how some of us actually got involved in research in the first place. We're fascinated by ideas. We want to make a difference, of course, but we're, in the very first instance, and this is what I say to my students, if you have a topic for a PhD and it doesn't keep you awake at night, you're not passionate about it, then, you know, what is the point of doing it? Do you see a sort of a disconnect here? Is there a real challenge at the level of one's own personal motivation in achieving that balance?
Yeah, I think on the face of it, one might think that. And I think when one looks at, you and I have similar levels of longevity in academic career. I think when one looks at when we started, then one would see things, you know, differently. And as you rightly said, if this doesn't excite you, if you are not passionate about the idea, not the application of the idea, then you are probably not going to be able to make a PhD. And I remember when I first started supervising PhDs, and indeed some of my earliest PhDs, you know, adopted that same attitude. You know, a guy called Lloyd Harris, who's a professor now at Manchester, was my first PhD student. And he probably remains as passionate as I was when I first supervised him. I've moved slightly away from that position. Now, my position at the time was always that if you cannot find a theoretical rationale, you shouldn't be doing research. If there is no theoretical rationale, you cannot be a PhD student. I cannot supervise your PhD. And at the time, I would have people who would come to me and say, I think I can apply this kind of in that environment. And I would be the person that would always say, context, my friend, is not a reason for doing research. You know, you do research because there is a theoretical rationale that you can contribute to. These days, I've kind of gone the other way around, where I'm thinking that actually context is just as important a reason for doing research as your theoretical rationale. You know, so I suspect I am a convert. The longer I have tried to apply some of the ideas that I have developed in my theoretical research, or that others have developed in their theoretical research, you know, I've become convinced that you have to have a blend of the two. You have to, particularly in some of our areas. I recognize that there are some colleagues whose research will be very difficult to contextualize in that sense, or to apply in the sense of having that type of or that level of impact. But I think everybody, every academic ought to try to be able to communicate their ideas, you know, especially where it is relevant, so that people can see how it can make a difference to their lives. I would never have known, you know, some of the differences that some of the work I've done at the theoretical level could make if I hadn't worked with the Welsh government over the last 2 years. And if I hadn't had the opportunity to be able to test some of them and to actually see that these are not just academic thinking, they can actually be applied in real life situations.
Right. Thank you very much for that response. Just moving on, what did you see as the practical challenges that scholars face, particularly early career scholars who are trying to make an impact and at the same time, you know, they want to establish themselves as thinkers, people who are making a contribution to theory?
I think the really good point. The problem you have as an early career researcher is that you don't have enough experience really to begin to think about, oh, what impact can I make? And you haven't actually established yourself for the most part in the profession. And what you want to do is to be known as somebody who is a thinker, because that is the thing that is going to give you the academic credibility that allows you to be able to make the impact that you are thinking of. And that's the conundrum there. You know, universities want the two, but actually you need to be able to probably establish yourself and then be able to go on to do the other things that you want to do. But you see, I think it depends on the individual and it depends on the context. You know, some people are able to do research, you know, for whatever reason, your PhD thesis, you know, may have, you know, some interesting impacts or elements of applicability to some context or some real world situation that may be there. And I think that's where it is important, you know, the point that Joe was making earlier, working closely with your research managers in your schools or departments, you know, the publicity teams, to say to them, here are my ideas. And you'd be surprised how they can write this up or how they can connect this to somebody outside who may actually find that useful. And your journey into impact may begin earlier than perhaps it would be for majority of people. I know for one that this was something that helped me an awful lot. It helped me a lot. It helped me to get a work permit in this country. I don't know how it was for you, Ken, but in my time in Cardiff, I was the first person that Cardiff University got a work permit for in 1990. They had never done it. And I remember at the time, the Home Office people were saying, you know, work permit, we cannot give a work permit to a guy who came to this country as a 17-year-old and now has a PhD. You know, work permits are for Japanese expats, you know, that are coming from Sony and Mitsubishi and so on and so forth. And one of the things that happened to coincide with the time they were deciding on this application and on the verge of rejecting it was that out of my PhD, my supervisor and I decided that there was something that was potentially interesting at the time in early 1990s when we were talking about the debates in this country was on enterprise culture. You will remember that, Ken. And there was something about consumerism from my PhD, and we wrote it up in New Statesman and Society, which was a very popular journal in those days, intellectual magazine in those days. And New Statesman and Society published this on their front page, and all the news media picked it up. And there was an interview on that on BBC Radio 4. And the guy that was deciding my work permit application listened to this interview, got to his office, and called the agent that was dealing with this on behalf of the university and said, I will give this man a work permit. So that kind of helped me in that sense as well.
Yeah. Thank you very much for sharing that. I would also like to mention something that was similar in the sense that when I finished my doctorate at Oxford University, and I was trying to get the book, the thesis published as a book, and publishers were saying to me, who is interested in Africa? You know, who cares? I found it really difficult to answer that question. But I went away and decided to extract a number of papers out of the thesis, published a number of articles. Some 3 or so years later, that's when I actually found these same publishers approaching me and saying, oh, we've seen you've got a track record of publishing journal articles. We would now like to publish a book. Do you have a book in mind? So it's really interesting how things turn out. But as a final thought, I'd just like to ask you, why is it important to understand that this route to impact is really important? Should researchers be thinking about impact as a way to get into the career? Just a final thought.
Yeah, I would say so. I would say so because you got a number of factors there. Number one is that you have to understand the environment, you know, in which you are working. This is the job we are doing. We need to understand the critical success factors. And impact has become one of the critical success factors. We know from the last ref that a good impact case is equivalent to potentially 4 top research papers in terms of the income that it attracts to an institution. So it is important for institutional finances. And if it is important for institutional finances, it becomes important for our own career progression. You know, so there will come a time when if you don't have it, you may not be promoted, as these things always change in that sense. But also, it's very important for our own fulfillment as academics. I know for a fact that from my point of view, that my greatest fulfillment in my academic career, I thought it would be the papers that I have published in some really good journals, but it's actually become the work I've done over the last 2 years with the Welsh government. That has been the thing that is giving me the greatest fulfillment to actually be in a position to contribute to making a change in people's lives. It's really fantastic. And anybody who's able to try and develop their work in that sense, you know, should be thinking of doing that.
Yeah, I totally agree. Some of the work that we've been doing in recent years is on Chinese investments in Africa. Now, as you well know, and as many people here will know, that Chinese businesses have moved heavily into Africa, up and down the continent, and that has been a controversial issue. And some of the work that we've done has actually been significant in many ways, in the sense that we've been able to work with policymakers. So this is another thing that's really important in terms of making our work meaningful, not just to organizations, to communities, but also with those who make policy. And this, I think, is going to become increasingly important. So what I would like to do now is just to hear the voices of the audience here. We've got a few more minutes remaining. So I don't know, Ade, if you want to take us through some of those questions that are coming up on the chat. But also, if people want to ask a question, I'm sure that our panelists will be happy to take those questions. Ade, do you want to, are you still there?
Yes, I'm here, yes.
Yeah. You have to just kind of take us through some of those questions, please.
Okay. Thank you very much. We've got a few here. You know, there was a point mentioned about early career researchers, you see our PhD students and their challenges, but we also find when speaking to even senior academics, people at senior lecturer level, associate professor readers, even professors still face some of these issues that have been mentioned by Professor Emmanuel Ogona. So maybe if you mind sharing a few tips about how, you know, academics at senior lecturer, associate professor, leadership, and even professorial level can also manage to, you know, tackle some of these issues. Because, I mean, it doesn't mean that because you're a senior lecturer now or a professor, you wouldn't still have your own peculiar challenges.
I think it's important for us to understand that we have a major problem of racism in UK universities. We know that it's not just because we are a group here that are affected by it, and as such, we are singing the chorus. The Equality and Human Rights Commission found that in 2019 that universities are institutionally racist. And the spokesperson for the Universities UK on Equality and Diversity, Professor Richardson, has asked his colleagues, vice chancellors, to acknowledge the charge of institutional racism and to begin to do something to eliminate the effects of that racism. No other vice chancellor has accepted that charge. So we know that there are problems. And these problems, of course, will impact on us in the work that we do. But what we have to do is to work against that institutional and systemic problem. And that's why it's very difficult for early career researchers. It's slightly easier the higher up one goes, because one is able to then learn how to navigate some of those difficulties and disadvantages as you progress through the ladder. But identifying that a problem exists is one thing, and then trying to find the skills to be able to overcome those problems will be another. How do we do that? We do that by trying to work with people who are more established than ourselves. You know, they can come from all sorts of backgrounds. You know, I know that there is always a temptation for one to look for a mentor that looked like oneself, because it's easier to communicate and to do all the things that people do in social groups when you are dealing with people who are like you. But often the people that you would work with will be unlike you. So you would have to try and develop that skill to navigate that relationship. One thing I find working with people who are unlike oneself is that they tend to be more withdrawn when they are dealing with you. So essentially, you have to get them out of their comfort zone. They are withdrawn because they don't want to be accused of racism. They don't understand how it is or what it is like, you know, to be talking to somebody or to be dealing with somebody that is different from them. So they bring in the shutters. So you have to try and get them to coast out of that. You know, one of the things I tell my students is when you go to work and you have your senior colleagues or mentors or manager, when you have your first meetings with them, you know, try and make them understand that you are open and willing, you know, to enter into any type of dialogue and to take any type of constructive criticism. You know, don't just criticize me, please, but tell me what I can do and how I can improve. Because there are two types of feedback we tend to get in workplaces. There is the feedback that is filtered, and there is a feedback that is unfiltered. Unfortunately, as Black people and ethnic minorities, and women for that matter, we tend to get the feedback that is filtered because people don't want to put themselves in trouble. So when you say, how am I doing? Somebody says, yeah, you're doing okay. Just a bit of this, a bit of that, you'll be fine. And then they go to somebody else and they provide them with detailed information they can use. What you want to do when you get into those types of relationships is to convince the person you are dealing with that they can be unfiltered when they are giving you feedback, and that you're not just going to cry racism every time something that you don't like is said to you. But that doesn't mean that you should be willing to accept anything that is said to you. If a racist incident occurs, you need to call it out. But not every criticism is tantamount to racism.
Yeah, there's a very important point. Thank you very much, Emmanuel, for that response. It's a very important question here from Martin Zobi for Joe, which actually reminds me of a recent paper that I saw, which said that a science journal, I think it was The Lancet, had decided that they're no longer going to be accepting papers by, say, Western scholars who go out and collect data in Africa, if they do not acknowledge Africa research, and if they do not acknowledge the contribution of African collaborators. So this question here, Joe, is for you. It's for Martin Zobiwi. It says, how does the UKRI perceive research impact on studies that jointly focus on Africa and the UK? And can such ideas be funded by the UK? So what's the perception here about the inclusivity of work that relates to Africa?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. So we fund a number of different types of activity, and there are different types of funding mechanism across UKRI. But I think there's a really important point at the heart of this about global research challenges and opportunities. So research is a global endeavour, and UKRI funds research into issues that center across the whole world. So net zero, for example, global food security, there's a whole set of issues. So yes, we do fund research that has impact in Africa. I think there's some really important points here about equitable partnerships and the attention that we pay in when we're designing our funding opportunities to make sure that the partnerships are designed in an equitable way, that there are equitable outcomes. And then, of course, the assessment of those projects is really important. My recommendation would be, so there may be specific funding opportunities that relate to where there might be impacts in Africa. But there are also our open funding opportunities, what's usually called responsive mode funding. And I think one of the things that may be beneficial, and I perhaps should have mentioned this earlier when we were talking about advice for people submitting applications, is there contact the person, the team that is leading on a funding opportunities, to check how your proposal fits with that funding opportunity. So often people would submit maybe a 1 or 2 page outline of a proposal and seek some advice on whether that fits with what we as a funder are looking for, or where that might be best positioned within the UKRI funding landscape. The short answer is yes, we do.
Thank you very much, Joe, for that response. I wonder if we could open this up and actually hear from members of the audience. What has been their experience of pursuing impact? What does it actually mean for you? What challenges are you facing, or have you been facing? What's preventing you from doing impactful research, particularly those who in Africa? Anyone wants to? Do we have any specific questions, or does anyone want to ask a question? I'm assuming, Ade, we still have some time. Is that
yes, the position? We still have about 8 minutes or so.
Okay.
Actually, I think we've got 15 minutes, so we can still ask.
Okay.
But in the meantime, there's a question here actually for you, Professor Ogunna, which says, kindly share your thoughts on how you think academics could sharply navigate from institutional and environmental handicaps to achieve impactful research. Okay.
I think it kind of built on some of the things I was saying earlier. You know, if I think there are more problems, obviously, for researchers from Black and minority ethnic communities. You know, for a start, there are so few of us, and so few people that look like us. So that means we have to really stand up for ourselves, you know, and also we owe it to one another, you know, to try and help and support our colleagues, especially those that are early career staff. That was why when I was asked to speak today, I quickly rescheduled one of the things I had to try and join in, you know, to share and some of the insights that I may have developed over the last 30 years or 32 years or so. Yeah. In terms of navigating this journey, I think one has to think about going above often their institutions. Institutions, unfortunately, are not always designed to benefit Black researchers, because there is a degree of anti-Blackness in many universities. You know, we have ethnic minority problems, but you look at the Black problem, You know, how many Black professors do we have? Again, I go back to my institution. I was the first Black person to be appointed a chair in 2002 in Cardiff. It took another 18 years for another Black person to be appointed, and it was in 2020 during the pandemic. And this is every year me going to the vice chancellor and saying, why are there no people like me in this place? You know, in the business school where I work, I have been there for about 30 years, 32 years or so. And in that time, I've only ever seen three people that look like me that work there as academics. But we have a lot of ethnic minorities, but there is just a degree of anti-Blackness. And I don't think it's peculiar to Cardiff, you know, because I was speaking to somebody at the Academy of Management the other day, and somebody mentioned to me that there are four fellows that are ethnic minorities. In that one, we happen to have two Blacks, you know, two Black fellows. But it is quite instructive in that sense. So that means we have to look after ourselves, and we have to look after one another, and we have to go out sometimes over the heads of the schools and appeal directly to the institutions that you want to work with. You know, if it is the government scheme, find out somebody who is interested in your area and write to them directly. You may be surprised they agree to see you, and you start the work, and then the institution supports it. But if you are waiting for the institution to help you in that sense, you may not always be successful, because resources are limited. And the white academics, unfortunately, clog that resources. They hog it, and they are the ones that benefit immensely from it. So I think one should be able to go above the institutional head and try and get the job done outside. And the second thing is to, if you have something that you think is worth doing, go to your head of department, go to your head of school, and try and make a case for yourself. Don't wait for anybody to make it for you, because they are not going to make it for you. And these days, you actually at a very opportune moment in the UK, anywhere, everyone is trying to be an ally, even if they don't mean it. You know, so this is a good time to go and drive your point. I'm asking anybody I know that is 1 year before their promotion, please apply this year. Apply for promotion, you know, because you don't get it now, nobody knows when the environment will change and we'll go back to the pre 2020 times. There are things we can do, but I recognize that life is more difficult for us.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I think many of us who are professors, a small number, have often found ourselves as the only one or one or two. And it's only after a concerted effort, to ask difficult questions, to push universities and schools to put mechanisms in place that are more inclusive, do you actually see any real meaningful change? So thank you for that input. I see someone's hand up. I don't know if you want to ask a question. It says FA. I'm not sure who that is.
Yeah, so we've got a hand up from Richard Kawai and then from Gillian Stokes. So Richard, maybe you can go first and then we'll have Gillian go second. But you have to make it very quick, 30 seconds because of time, as we still have many more questions to take. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So thanks, Professor, for the clarity. So I also realize I'm an early researcher, I'm early academic, just about 2-3 years into it now. But I realize I happened to work with the US government for almost 6 years before coming here. And I realized there's some cultural differences in terms of the US and then the UK. I may be wrong, please correct me. The US are more blunt. They will tell you straight to the face, like you are saying, give me criticisms, which is raw, which is unfiltered. But of course, with the UK, what I've realized within the past few years is that they will polish it. They will try to polish it, go around the bush before they tell you. So it has to do with like some cultural differences. So how can we break this? Because it's something which is rooted in the genes for years. You see, so I find it's because today you see them smiling with you, telling you all the right things, but right behind you, they don't like you. But for the US, what I've realized with them, they'll tell you, I hate you, stay away. Then you know where to channel your rules. So how can we break through this? Is it not too difficult for us, especially with the young ones in academia? Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good point, actually. And you are right about the cultural differences. But again, I would say that once you get your white colleagues, my experience in academia, you know, some of my best friends in academia, either people I've supervised or people I've worked with are white people. And once you get into a relationship with them, then they become no different, because then they see you as just another person. They're not scared. People are scared of the unknown. And I think we have to understand that. It's not fair, it's not right, but it is real and meaningful. So networking, very important. I know it's not something that we like to do, especially those of us that are Africans. You know, we don't want to go into a room and go straight to somebody. You know, Ken will tell you with the same, the experience. When we first started in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, you go to a conference and you are the only black face in a room of 200 people. You know, so as soon as you enter, you see yourself being watched by everyone. You know, so to develop that courage to go into the group of people and start talking to them, it's not an easy skill to develop. But those people who are able to do it, I think, would find that it's easier for them to remove that barrier that exists. It isn't our problem, but unfortunately, we are the ones that would have to find a solution to it, because for white people, it doesn't even exist. You know, remember, many of them don't even believe discrimination is a thing.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. Who was going to go next?
Question. Gideon Stokes.
Gideon, okay, go ahead.
Yeah. I will take the question as well.
Hello, let me just put my hand down, because that's always irritating when that stays up. That was really, really interesting. Thank you very much for your candor, really, with that. I'd like to sort of firstly back you up on what you've just said there, Emmanuel. But, you know, I'm the one black face of my 112 staff in my department. And one of the things I have done is sort of put my research on hold for a little bit to try and encourage other students, you know, smart students that I've seen who are black students, to progress. And I think it is this: who's in my shadow, who's coming up with me, who are we taking with us? And I think we all have a responsibility to take people with us, and if we recognize that talent, we should be encouraging them to go on. I'm really proud that two of my master's students have now gone to PhD. Sorry, that's the end of my rant. Sorry, Adi, I know you're conscious of time. But I just wanted to say that I think we're always talking about decolonizing the curriculum, decolonizing the research in this country. And it's not an easy ask for anyone. We're not expecting it to be an easy ask. But one of the things I did put in the chat is, Joe, this is directed to you specifically. How can we start to prioritise and shift the gaze of the research? Because there's a lot of research that's being done on minority ethnic groups in the UK, Black Africans, Black Caribbeans. But having the inside of you and encouraging people who have cultural relevance and cultural experience may help to develop more relevant questions and generate more relevant and practical outputs from research, more impactful research, because that's what we're talking about today. How could UKRI help that to happen? Sorry, it's a big question.
It's a big question, and I don't think I can do justice to an answer, but let me have a go at some of the work that we're doing. So I think there's something really important about who participates in research and how do people participate. So we kind of have a tagline for our organization about by everyone for everyone. But what does that really mean? So that means really thinking carefully about research design. Who is asking the questions? How are those questions being asked? How are communities involved? Not about doing research to people, but doing research with people and inviting those contributions. And I think there's a number of different activities across UKRI that are supporting this work through our public engagement programmes. There's some activities at the moment on public dialogue. How do we bring in new voices? There's always a lot of focus in research proposals for certainly the biological and medical sciences on including sex and gender in research design. But we're really thinking much more broadly than that. This isn't just about sex and gender. It's about bringing people into the research. And then I think importantly, into the strategy development and into the design of funding opportunities. So there's a long way for us to go. It's a very live topic for us at the moment. In terms of the design, bringing people in, representation. So there's a really important question that's come up about this isn't just about diversity, it's about intersectionality, it's about inclusion, it's about bringing expertise and experience. We can't just have token gestures of inviting people to participate. And I think these are really live issues for UK research and innovation at the moment. I know that doesn't give you a straightforward answer, but I just want to convey that these are really big topics for us. And there are ways that people can get involved. We run consultations, we run exercises where we ask people to participate. That might be in user research for our new funding service. But if you can, and I know that time is really precious for everyone, seek out these opportunities and get involved, because we need to hear from all voices working within the research and innovation system.
I think that is very encouraging, Jo, which hopefully will give us a clearer sense of our own initiative, our own agency in bringing about change. So do we have any other questions out there? I think we still have a few more minutes.
Yes, we do. We do. We've got a couple of hands up, but before we go there, we need to take a couple of questions. One was, how do we circumvent this challenge in seeking for a host, where we send several emails to white lecturers or researchers but won't respond to any, and the one who eventually responded said they have been warned to even open email to Africa. Who wants to go for that?
I'm not sure who is going to. Emmanuel, do you want to have a quick go at that? Do you stop your colleagues from answering emails from Africa?
Certainly not. I'm probably not the best person to ask, because unfortunately for me, my research doesn't have an awful lot to do with Africa in the way that, say, Ken does. So I don't tend to get those types of emails to ask me to collaborate or to do things, because it's simply not the type of thing that I do. But I think there is that we all know about the Afro-pessimism stuff, which is kind of pervading society. And I think it is a thing that universities or institutions will latch onto, you know, that this will become a scam email and so on and so forth. But I don't think that's always the case. If somebody is writing to you from a University of Lagos or somewhere, then they are an academic. And I'm sure there are many people that will open it, particularly if that is the area of research they are doing. If it isn't, they are not likely to open it any more than they would open an email from Singapore or Malaysia, or that they will respond to it if it doesn't interest them.
Yeah, I don't see it as a particularly big issue, frankly. I mean, I do get lots of emails from people in Africa, people that I've either collaborated with or you recognize them with the university and so forth. But I think the issue for me is what it signals about the lack of capacity in Africa, where sometimes you get an email from a student saying they would like to run some ideas by you, because they can't get supervisory input, and I think that is tragic. Of course, as the director of the Africa Research Group, which works closely with universities across Africa, you know, there's always an ongoing engagement, so that's useful from that point of view. But I think it is also sad that in many cases you will have researchers who are not getting any support at all in their institutions, and then they're then reaching out to you. So of course we welcome this input, this idea of reaching out, but we also think it's really sad that the capacity is lacking, and there needs to be something which also signals perhaps the lack of finding opportunities. And I was hoping that we could hear some voices from people on the continent who perhaps have been experiencing challenges in securing funding, making and having an impact in their work, because I think that would make for a very interesting discussion. But I think our time is running out, Adair, yes, although I don't know if we can squeeze in one final question.
Yes, we'll take a final question, which is from Dr. Tiro Mani, who's also one of our guest speakers. And she's saying, and this is for you, Joe, what is UKRI doing to take into account intersectionality among applicants? Because representations alone does not mean meaningful diversity. If a group is being represented by the wrong person or the person with little understanding of the challenges of Black academics, and that's a very important question, by the way. So, Joe, over to you, please. Thank you.
Yeah, a really important question. So in terms of our data, we collect data on four characteristics at the moment, and we're starting to do some analysis of the intersectionality across those data sets, which will help us to understand better the data that we have. But I think that's not really the question here. I think this is more a question about inclusion and expertise, bringing expertise to the table, and representation. So I think there's a lot here in terms of what we're doing. So our councils are certainly looking at constitution of the peer review panels, so improving diversity and representation within those panels. And I think there's a really important point that this is not just about ticking boxes for diversity. This is about creating environments where people can share their voices, bring their voices, feel comfortable, feel included, and importantly, bring their expertise and experience and knowledge to bear on the decision making that we're doing. There's a wealth of activity to support this work. And I think there were often calls for people to apply to be on peer review panels, for example. And again, I would just encourage people to be bold and submit an application and add your voice to the community that is supporting the decision making around the research and innovation in the UK.
On that note, friends, I'll bring this session to a close. I'd like to thank Emmanuel and Joe very much for your thoughts, your reflections, and those very practical bits of information that you've shared with us. Thank you very much. And to all of you, thanks a lot. And we look forward to seeing you in the next session. Over to you, Ade.
Thank you very much, Professor Ken Kamuche. Thank you, Professor Emmanuel Obona. Thank you, Joe O'Larry, for sacrificing your time to be here with us today. I know that you guys are very busy people, so thank you so much. We do appreciate you coming. Thank you, everyone else, for joining us so far. Our next session starts at 11:20, so just about 6 minutes, in 6 minutes' time. If you've asked any questions and we've not been able to take them, please don't worry. We will probably direct them to our next speakers, who can be able to, of course, pick them up. We've got a 5 minutes break now, so please go and take your break, get a cup of coffee, tea, water, etc., and we will be back for the next session, which is on tools and techniques for impact. So what are the strategies and how do we approach this? And we've got two speakers at that session, Professor Funmi Olonishaki from King's College London and Professor Kemi Yekini. And of course, Dr. Teremoni Naden, who is here with us today, will be chairing that session. Thank you very much, everyone, and see you soon. But in the meantime, we have a mentoring scheme that we are currently working on. So Professor Bona, you mentioned mentoring, which is a very important aspect for, you know, impact. And hopefully we will reach out to, you know, our pool of academics to participate, to help with our mentoring scheme. And we do hope that when we do that, you will be willing to help with mentoring, especially for early career researchers, as you mentioned. Thank you very much.
Okay. Can I just say one thing before we finish? I think there were some voices that said something about trying to grow the pipeline. I think it's very important that we do that. Currently, I have two fully funded PhD studentships. I think if people know anybody who is interested in doing a PhD, unfortunately, it's Welsh government money, so they can't sponsor people who don't have a right to work in the United Kingdom, so to say. If you know anybody who wants to do a PhD, please, you know, point them our way to try and look at the opportunity of growing that pipeline that we are talking about. Because if we don't have people that are doing PhDs, we are not going to have people who are going to be the lecturers and professors of tomorrow.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. We will definitely note that down. Thank you so much. I'll probably contact you personally, and then I'll get the details, and we can publish that on our social media platforms. Thank you.
Thank you,
everyone. Bye-bye. Thank you very much. And we'll see you in just about 3 minutes for our next session. Sorry, we had so many questions in this session and took a lot of time. Thank you.
Let's get together and feel all right.
Hear the children crying.
One love.
Hear the children crying.
One love.
Saying give thanks and praise.
Get together and feel all
right. Oh, oh, oh. Let them not fight from the earth to reap out.
One love.
There is one question right away.
One heart.
You stay with me. One love. Who bless sinners who have hurt all mankind.
Just
say this so believe.
One love.
Let's get together to fight this holy young Gideon.
One love.
When the man comes, there will be no doom.
One love.
Chance if growth stand, there ain't from the Father of creation.
One love. Get together and feel all right.
I'm pleading to mankind.
One.
Dance
and praise to the Lord.
And
feel all right.
Okay. Romani, are you there?
Yeah, can you hear me, Ade?
Yes, fantastic. I can.
I've had to earlier come out and then come back, and I'm not seeing the speakers in yet, are they?
Let me see. Just bear with me. I'm gonna put you on the spot.
Oh, I saw Professor Lani Shakin. Yeah, I'll just pin her for me. Hello.
Hello, Professor Lani Shakin. Hello, Professor.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Can you hear me, please?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
All right. So, Hermani, you can start now introducing the speakers, and then we get on to the next session. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, welcome. Welcome, everyone, for the third session. We have today Professor Kemi Yekini with us, and we also have Professor Funmi Olanishakin. And in this session, the third session of the SBA conference is on tools and techniques for impact. And the theme of today's big conference is research and impact and scholarship, sorry. And we're also going to look at strategies on and how to approach them. We have among us today people of various roles, so people who are senior researchers, mid researchers, early career researchers, and also several PhD research students. And I've also been informed that we have people outside the UK who've joined us, and I saw from the chat people from Dubai, Nigeria, and we've got a few members from senior management, also from a few universities. So we are going to approach this session and discuss the tools and techniques and strategies, hopefully to be helpful for all the categories of audience. I'm also mindful that this session, this third session, is between you and lunch. So I'll be taking some of the questions that appear in the chat also in the 40 minutes of chat with the professors. Maybe to start, as a start, if we could have a 2 minutes intro from Professor maybe Olanishakin first, and then we'll move to Professor Yekini.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so much. I really, really appreciate this. Let me start actually by paying tribute to all of you who started this network. It's much needed. It's an idea whose time, you know, has come actually, should have been before now. So thank you so much for making this possible. A little bit about myself. Of course, I'm Funmi Olanishakin. I first came to academia in the UK to be a postgraduate student in the late 80s. And I thought I would come here, return quickly to my country to do some really exciting things. And then I stayed, but I also spent some time at the United Nations in New York for about 3.5 years, where I worked in the office of the Special Representative of the Secretary General for Children and Armed Conflict. I wanted to say that as a way of introducing myself as someone who's an academic, but who's really directly immersed in the world of policy and practice. And that has been so from the start, because I came to academia with a very clear mission to affect particular areas of change. That has since evolved. At the moment, I'm a professor in the African Leadership Center at King's, but also vice president for global engagement. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move to Professor Yekini, if we could have a short intro of you, please? You're muted.
Hello, can you hear me now?
We can indeed, thank you.
Okay, so sorry. I just want to thank the organizers of this event for inviting me to be part of it. I never knew the society existed, and I was surprised when I saw the videos from last year's because I wasn't even aware that happened. Anyway, to go to introducing myself, I am Kemi Yekini, and I'm a professor of accounting at SWAS University of London. I started my career really as a chartered accountant, working with KPMG in those days, known as Pitmawick, Annie Ogundi and Co. So I qualified with them and then moved quickly to join Deloitte, where I, you know, spent a larger part of my practice life. And I also, you know, worked as a chief internal auditor with one of the Deloitte client. Then I left Deloitte and joined that client. So I'm saying all of this because I'm going to go back to it when during the session. So, but at the moment, as well as I am the director of doctoral studies and a similar role I have also held with the University of Nottingham and the Montfort University, where I actually started my academic career. And just like Professor Funmi, I also came in for postgraduate studies and eventually had to stay. I was looking for, you know, a career that would give me more time for my family. And that was why I left practice and I came into academia. But unfortunately, I realized that the time I said I wanted, I still did not get, because I got engaged with research and so many of the race in the academia. And so my research interests, you know, given my background as an accountant, so I, you know, enjoy looking at the transparency of corporate reporting, especially the narrative aspects. And I've also delved into forensic accounting, given the skills I learned from practice. I had to, you know, develop that skill, obtain the qualification in as a certified fraud examiner, and I've also started doing things in forensic. But really, I would say my research interest is multidisciplinary. I have used linguistic approach even in my research, which has also given my research some impact, which I'm going to talk about later on. So basically, that's me. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Professor Yekini. So I'll just start with Professor Olanishakin on the topic. What tools and techniques you have yourself probably used or you found useful for impactful research and scholarship throughout, you know, your career? And then we'll go to the next speaker.
Thank you. Maybe just three short things, really, and I'm happy to expand on those things later. The first is I've always taken a problem solving or solutions-based approach to my research. As I said earlier, I became a university-based researcher because I wanted to take, you know, a knowledge building and intellectual, I wanted to establish the intellectual basis for some of the problems that I wanted to solve. Initially, it was I was looking broadly at military coups before I would say I literally was sleepwalking into, whilst researching that, into the idea that economic institutions can actually take a big, you know, make a big change in the area of peacekeeping and peace building. So my master's and PhD degrees were in war studies. But I especially was trying to problem solve by, you know, understanding how you build an inclusive kind of peace in societies that are affected by, you know, perpetual, if you like, military coups, armed conflicts, and so on. That problem solving approach meant that I always, and that's to the second point, I always worked with people. It means that you have a network on the outside. I've always had networks on the outside of institutions because of the bigger ambition to make change with that research. So the problem itself that I'm trying to solve has always informed the research, but I've also worked with a network, either because I take a working group approach to have sounding boards, but also to work with the people that are likely to implement the outcomes of that research, and the deep ethical questions that I had to resolve initially. And I think that has always remained as well, because I was at once embedded in different external institutions that I was studying and also doing collective problem solving in that respect. But the third thing I want to say, actually, which is the biggest part of it, is the products of the research cannot always be. And actually, again, at King's, and many, you know, it's been very instructive for me. I was one of those researchers who didn't work on the basis that I needed to publish in five-star publications. I did it to belong, but I did many other things with the products of my research all at once. And actually, I was researching and publishing in different ways before the idea that you had to rate impact of research. And ever since impact became one of the things you measured in the ref, I had been submitted constantly. In fact, I was more visible outside of King's than I was on the inside of King's. I suddenly became visible inside King's because impact had become part of what was measured in REF, and my work was admitted almost immediately. This year, the same thing, my research has continued, notwithstanding university leadership. I was submitted for REF, and my case study was part of that. And so the continuity of my research has always been a thing. It's one common, it's one narrative, but with multiple parts, whether you find that part in media, in research, in academic journals or policy publications. So the life and living have always been connected in that sense. So I don't know whether that says enough about techniques, but those three things I would say.
Yeah, thank you. You mentioned around problem solving, which is very true. And earlier, actually in the earlier session, I think it was the first session today, Dr. Doyin Atewo-Lukun earlier mentioned around collaboration, which you said around working with people. And she also mentioned in her in the same line of thought around seeking feedback, even on things like application for grants, application for promotions, and even drafts of publication. What are your thoughts? I'm just dragging from what you've just said there. What are your thoughts on the techniques and the skills needed on approaching peers when you're seeking collaboration and even feedback? You said about, actually, you are a global scholar before you even got recognized at King's. So what was your approach there and the strategies that help you to first become a global scholar along with the mindset of, you know, the collaboration?
Thank you. I mean, everything sounds very smooth when I say it in this way, but because some of it I was doing it and I didn't call it a name. But there are two things that I think I did consistently, and I agree with Doyin there on that collaboration. First, I always looked for who was affected by the same problem I'm solving. And sometimes I was right at the center of that problem as well. If you really look at women's representation in peacekeeping or in military institutions, for example, it meant you had to look for, you had to build mutuality with affected communities. But the second thing was who was responding to those problems, whether they were on your side or not. Sometimes they were important power holders. And so I used my research problem to connect the two communities. One, you're actually networking because you're trying, you're working in solidarity with them. The other one, you're on the opposing side, but you're trying to influence them. And if you think of what became the African Security Sector Network, that is how we worked. So the concept, the idea that you wanted to build research around women, peace and security, just as an example, same for youth and peace building, you took to the constituents that were affected by it. Is this a good idea? Do you want to collaborate? And actually they would normally be downstream because they are they will validate that research at some point, but they're also, some of them were gatekeepers, but they will open doors for you in the field and so on and so forth. So over time I built, you know, those networks, and actually we all also founded things together. The African Security Sector Network, we worked like that very loosely until we consolidated ourselves into a network that then became a global network. And I can mention two or three things like that. I absolutely think that having them look at the concept, sometimes they tell you that that won't work. This is not how it is on the outside. So you already strengthen the concept before it goes in. You build them into the research grant as part of your dissemination process. They're there ready for you to open doors. Like I said earlier, sometimes there are ethical issues and you have to make decisions about the limits to which you'll collaborate. And there are many times that happened to me. But I think the collaboration, from my perspective, absolutely important. Feedback, also using them as gateway to influence and dissemination, absolutely important.
Thank you so much, Professor Olanishaki, and especially on what you just said about who's responding to that problem. I'll move to Professor Yikini now. If you could share around some of the tools and techniques that you've used, and also follow up a bit from what has just been said around responding to problems. I'll actually let you tackle the first bit first, and then I'll go on with the other bit of question.
Thank you very much, Tavon. From my own perspective and from, you know, the work I have done, And, you know, again, because you said the topic says impactful research and scholarship. So I have looked at my career to date from both angles. And I would say what could assist for impactful research and scholarship can be looked at from two perspectives, especially from my perspective, what has helped me. And that is pedagogy, that is teaching excellence and research excellence. For pedagogy, I know, you know, they would usually say maybe be innovative, write books and all of that. But for me, bringing my professional skills, you know, my life in practice, bringing it into my teaching has actually given me impact. And it's one of the things that has put me out there. Apart from my research itself, I'm going to talk about my research, but what do I mean by bringing your skill into teaching? You know, from my experience in practice as working with KPMG and Deloitte, and even working as a chief internal auditor at some point, I developed this skill of being able to uncover fraudulent activities. And as a result, I decided to develop the skill further by getting, you know, some qualification to back that up. And so when I started my career at De Montfort University then, it was just around the time when they were trying to introduce an MSc program in forensic. And so I was part of that team that started that program. And, you know, unknown to me, I didn't realize I was doing anything. I was just teaching and bringing my skills and experience into my teaching. And to my surprise, sometimes in 2016, I received an invitation from, you know, a South Korean radio called TBS EFM. And, you know, they asked me to talk on, you know, to share expert opinion on corporate accounting fraud. So I was surprised. How did you know me? I haven't even done any research on corporate fraud. All I know is that I was able to start it at the Montfort as an MSc program, and I've also taught on that program. But then, you know, they invited me to give a talk on that show. And then just last month, some faculty from the University of Dhaka in Bangladesh also reached out to me to say, we were in contact with some of your students and they said you are the right person to contact. We want to start an MSc program in forensic in our university and we want you to come and share your thoughts with us. You know, that university being one of the, you know, highly ranked university in the country, they said they want a situation where all other universities that want to introduce the same program will use them as, you know, we look at what they have done. And because they are a top university, they wanted to get it right. And so they invited me to have a meeting with me to see how they can start that program in their university. I see that as impact because how did they know me out there? I haven't even done any serious research in forensic other than starting it at the Montfort, starting it also at SUAS, because I was able to introduce a module in forensic accounting also at SUAS. And at the moment, I'm introducing a center which I have called Forensic Accounting Forensic Accounting Research Center. Yes, Forensic Accounting. You know, what I was trying to do with that center is to do a consulting kind of work. And this is because of, you know, the various impact. I think probably my teaching, you know, because it appears to me that my students, wherever they go, they tend to talk about my teaching on in that program. So I see that as impact. And I think it's also a tool, you know, teaching innovation or teaching excellence, what bringing your skills, your experience, you know, whatever experience we have in practice, for those who have worked in practice before joining academia like myself, whatever experience you have should never be a waste. Bring it to your teaching, make it life. And with that, you can also generate some impact. So that's teaching excellence. I don't know if I've answered your question, but research excellence is,
Yeah. You have. Thank you, Professor Yekini. Actually, this leads to my next question, which was going to be around mentoring. There seems to have been a lot of appetite today. I don't know if you've attended the earlier two sessions. There has been a lot of appetite and even somebody asking, oh, we could be doing something like that in the SBA and people volunteering even to mentor. There's the common saying that behind every successful man, there's a woman. And in academia, behind every successful scholar, I think there is a mentor, and if not many mentors along your career, whether be it in your home country or in the UK, even outside Europe, who are constantly, you know, helping you to even become global scholars. What are your thoughts and techniques around this? What are your views on finding the right mentor as a tool to navigate through the HE sector and also for impactful research and scholarship? And this question goes to both of you. Maybe we'll go to Professor Olanishakin to be the first to answer on this one.
Thank you. Let me just first and foremost say that I couldn't agree more with Professor Kemi's point there. Kemi, I think, so brilliantly said. That actually the life-changing aspect of this, you know, for a student, I experienced it myself, is that of a professor in the classroom who brings real life experience to their work and who's been able to create programs from real life challenges. I really am intrigued by that. I hope that that center, you know, becomes successful. On mentoring, I should say that, again, something I stumbled upon. Because as I told you, I came into academia because I wanted to find answers to particular problems that I not only experienced, but I also saw from around me on questions of peace and security, especially security. As soon as I got to the United Nations, I realized that even though I loved the ideals of that organization, they were very far, very, very far from achieving those ideals. You hardly saw a young African in the corridors of the United Nations. Yet African issues occupied more than 50% of the agenda of the UN Security Council. African leaders who sat in the General Assembly for committees that I serviced, like the Third Committee, were either not present. I know I'm generalizing very wildly because there were very few exceptions, and I want to acknowledge that. They were either not present or not speaking or actually seemed disinterested, and they were mostly old men, all right? And yet Africa was being discussed. I left the United Nations resolved as a scholar. I mean, I wrote on peacekeeping, wrote enormously, collaborated across peace and security and military-related subjects, and researched on this. When I returned to King's, because I took a break from King's to go to the UN and I came back to King's, when I returned, it was obvious to me that if we didn't create a community of young Africans who were steeped and understood really deeply the art and science of how you represented on your issues, we would just be moving in those cyclical patterns. And this is where, it's one thing to talk about problem solving in theory, and that's a methodology itself. In the social science and even more with engineering as well, I would say. But it's another thing to provide those solutions yourself. And this is where, for me, mentoring came into it and building a community. Because actually, if we don't build a community around the problems that we're solving in an intergenerational way, we don't get there. So what became the African Leadership Center that I first started at King's and then worked with my colleagues to establish in Nairobi, started with a small pilot program, which was to bring three African women. If I said there were barely young Africans at the UN, young women were so rare, right? Bring three to King's a year. These were well-established people in their own right, mid-career. They have either first or second degrees already. They were working as lawyers, bankers, scientists, but they did not actually understand the discourse of peace, security, and development. Immerse them in it for either an entire academic year or 6 months, then attach them to a practicing institution on it, including the UN itself, African Union, and get them to begin to problem solve. That required an amazing amount of intergenerational mentoring, because first you taught them to be really excellent researchers and then taught them to translate that research into policy and practice. And I didn't think, and this, we started in 2005 developing this program. Then we founded the African Leadership Center itself in 2010. And it meant building all manner of networks. But the cross-mentoring that comes from a young person from Zimbabwe or from Burkina Faso, bringing their own case study into the classroom, transformed to the King's classroom too. My colleagues, I have to say this, when I was starting this center, said, we will not lower our standards for Africans. And I said, you will never, ever have to do that. Now we have a master's program in it, a PhD program, and I myself became a researcher of leadership because I understood leadership in the layperson's world, and then understood that there's a whole academic world out there on leadership that you needed to translate differently to solve these problems. So being mentored by those students, by those fellows in return, I think it's such a brilliant thing. As far as I'm concerned, it's a building a lifelong relationship. It is understanding that you're learning from the person that you're mentoring, that you're supposed to be mentoring intellectually, and that they're learning from you. And that role changes over time. So I've loved it. And when I hear what Kemi is saying, I think you're beginning a journey that could just really, you know, transform the space of accounting differently for Africa. Thank you. I hope I didn't go on for too long. Sorry about that.
Thank you. No, we've still got time. And I wonder if Professor Yekini has anything to add on the topic of mentoring, maybe some lived experience to share on that.
Yeah, I can't agree more with Professor Fumi on the importance of mentoring. And, you know, I put it down as the number one in the strategy. You know, the session given to us is to talk about the strategy needed to uncover potential and impactful research. And the number one thing I put down there is academic mentor. For one to really succeed in this career, you will definitely need a mentor. Well, when I say a mentor, you have to be careful who you choose as your mentor, because at times, if you choose someone who sees you as a threat, they will sabotage rather than support you to achieve, you know, your aim. But then you have to be careful to choose someone you know believes in you, is there to, you know, to support you, and will always want to give you objective opinion on your work and you know, the direction to follow. And I would say that when I started at De Montfort, my mentor then, even though I did not really approach him to say, I want you to be my mentor, but he just saw me and picked an interest in me and called me to his office to say, you know what, you have just finished your PhD and I just want to counsel you. This is how to go about it. This is what you shouldn't get involved with. This is what you should do. And in fact, the advice I got from him is, I would say, was the foundation of what led to all of the papers I have written, all of the, what all I have achieved in my career today. So having a mentor is very important, but you have to be careful to choose the right mentor.
You've actually hit it on the nail there, especially on my next question, which was going to be allies. There seems to be in the UK, especially after the Black Lives Matter movement and George Floyd's death, there seems to have been a lot of people who've come out to be as allies. And there seems to be a lot of appetite for allyship, but nonetheless, there can be a lot of performative allyship, which helps no one really. And what tools or what strategies, I mean, especially with what you've just said around, yes, you can have a mentor who's not really acting as a mentor, but misguiding you, or who can have, you know, there can be vindicative measures or something like that. Do you have strategies that you can share around identifying the right ally? Because we are not just Black people, Black academics in the industry. We are surrounded by people of other color and by white people as well. So I'll maybe Professor Yekini, if you could go on that one first.
Thank you for that question. You remember that I mentioned that for my mentor, he just piqued interest in me. He realized that I was a young academic who, well, even though I was coming from practice and I've approached my PhD with so much rigor, and I have done, you know, according to what he said to me then, an outstanding piece of work, which he said I could publish even 4-star from. You know, that was where he started with me. He gave me that objective opinion. He said, you know what you have done, because he was actually my internal examiner. He was the internal examiner for my PhD. He said, what you have done in that piece of work is outstanding. And I tell you, you can publish 4-star from that, from your work. You can get nothing less than 3 articles from it. And I tell you, that was exactly what happened. I published 4 articles from my thesis alone, and 3 of them were published in top journals. So he piqued interest in me, and he was very objective about it. You know, it's those sort of people that one should, you know, actually approach if you need to approach anyone at all, or if you see someone who has piqued interest in you and is willing to give you, you know, constructive advice on your work, you should, you know, go along with such a person. Such a person is a good ally. You know, I remember Professor Emmanuel Ogbonna saying the other time that, you know, at times people of other color, they don't want to be too close because they are being careful not to be accused of racism, which is true. And which is, I mean, to be fair to them, they wouldn't want a situation where they will give you some feedback and then you will see it as racism. For example, one of the things my mentor told me then was that, don't go about having coffee with it. You know, the university I started from, De Montfort, then was a teaching university. And so most of the staff were more into teaching than research. And so he said to me, Kemi, you know what? Everybody here is into, they are more aligned towards teaching. And you are a researcher. You have done an outstanding job. Don't go about drinking coffee with them. They would invite you for coffee, but just be polite enough to say, I have some papers I'm working on, focus on your research and make sure you get something good out of it. So it was, if that was coming to me from another color, because he's from, you know, he's an Asian, he's India. So I see him as one of my own people. So if he was coming to me from maybe a white colleague, I would have said maybe he's racist. Maybe he didn't want me to, you know, have alliance with the white people. But then this is my own person. And he's saying to me, you know what? They will invite you for coffee. They will invite you to gossip with you. Make sure you don't get carried away by their invitation. Sit down, focus on bringing quality papers out of your thesis, and that is what we mark the start of an outstanding career.